hard dynamics between Thomasine and her father, which ended in unequal. Even if widowhood conferred onto Thomasine a degree of legal agency, Heminges' request that Thomasine humble herself as a condition for payment seems, to me at least, to consciously reinscribe and reinforce these dynamics. The case, S, of Thomasine Ostler, gender, fiction, and theatre history in common law court, records Jonathan Powell, author, notes the Review of English Studies, published the 12th of October, 2024. Abstract: this article asks what theatre historians can, and can't, learn from the records of Thomasine Ostler in the Court of King's Bench between 1615 and 1619, during which period Ostler filed suit not only against her father, the actor John Heminges, but also the son of Walter Raleigh. Ostler's name is not unfamiliar to scholars, but neither she nor the enrolments of her suits have been examined in detail, and both have been misunderstood or simply overlooked. The article hinges on a new way of working with the plea rolls of England's common law courts, whose Latin entries have long been seen as limited repositories of essential facts to be extracted from smokescreens of formalism and legal fiction. This article argues instead that plea rolls should be understood as sites of fiction-making, and uses Ostler's suits to show why their constitution of character and plot should matter to theatre historians. The article thereby casts light on not just the ownership of playhouse shares contested by Ostler and Heminges, but the actions, motivations, and interpersonal relationships of all three parties in Ostler's suits. It also challenges scholars to rethink the value of plea rolls as sources for women's lives and stories. Introduction: Thomasine Ostler was 19 years old when her husband, the actor William Ostler, died suddenly on the 16th of December, 1614.1. William had died without leaving a will, and so Thomasine applied for the administration of his estate, which was granted to her on the 22nd of December. Two amongst William's assets were two playhouse shares, a 1/7 interest in the Blackfriars Playhouse and a 1/14 interest in the ground lease of the Globe. Three of these shares were not, however, in William's possession, but, rather, in the hands of his fellow actor, John Heminges, who was not only William's colleague but Thomasine's father, and in no mood to relinquish possession, for like so many other women and men in early modern England, Thomasine turned to the law, albeit only after months of requests to her father for restitution had gone ignored. Thomasine first instigated suit in the Equity Court of Chancery on the 20th of September, 1615, before shortly afterwards filing a common law bill in the Court of King's Bench, likely on the 9th of October. Both suits are known to theatre historians thanks to the latter's enrolment in the plea rolls for Hilary term 1616. Indeed, prior to this article, no further documents related to either suit had been located. This enrolment has significance for the details it contains concerning the division and ownership of playhouse shares, including the original indentures for the ground lease of the Globe, drawn up in 1599, and the composition of the seven-man consortium to whom Richard Burbage issued shares in the Blackfriars in 1608. These details have appeared in work on William Shakespeare's career, Shakespeare being a named party in the original indentures, and, more recently, in scholarship interested in the structures and practices of the King's Men. Six few, however, beyond Alan H. Nelson and Lucy Monroe, appear to have consulted the original document, and little attention has been paid by scholars to Thomasine Ostler herself. 7. This article therefore not only reassesses what theatre history can learn from the enrolment of Ostler versus Heminges, but asks what the discipline can take away from documents of Thomasine's legal experiences more broadly. Most significant amongst these documents is the enrolment of a suit instigated in the spring of 1616 against the son of the poet and courtier Walter Raleigh, which, like many of the documents relating to Thomasine in her life, has been misinterpreted, if considered at all. That the enrolments themselves have received little attention is not hugely surprising given what the legal historian J.H. Baker has described as the terse formalism of common law plea rolls, not to mention the more routine challenges of access, language, and paleography, that is their use of court hand, that these records pose, 8 composed in abbreviated Latin on lengthy sheets of parchment, each more than half a meter long. Plea rolls constituted the official record of all three of England's central common law courts, the Court of Common Pleas, the Exchequer of Pleas, and the Court of King's Bench. This trio of courts were England's busiest during a period of unprecedented and still unsurpassed litigiousness, and entertained more than 100,000 suits per year between them by the beginning of the 17th century. Nine of the three, the records of the King's Bench, in particular, have been drawn upon by more than a century of pioneering theatre historical scholarship. Ten, whilst this work has resulted in important discoveries, however, the strict, repetitive nature of common law plea rolls has also encouraged scholars to view them as rather limited repositories of essential facts that need to be extracted from what David Mattie describes as smokescreen, s, of formalism and legal fiction. 1.1 Most simply, the forms and fictions of common law records have been seen as barriers to historical understanding, and this has resulted in an extractive approach to enrolments such as that of Ostler versus Heminges, whereby the entries' details of shares and sharers have been isolated from their procedural, linguistic, and wider documentary contexts. In this article, I therefore call for a new approach to these sources, arguing that they should be understood as sites of fiction-making. I do so through an exemplary focus on the formal composition of the first stage in common law pleadings, the plaintiff's narration or opening count, this latter term a legal inflection of conte, which remains the French word for a tale or story. I argue that it is precisely the common law strict, formulary framework that, perhaps paradoxically, enabled hitherto unrecognized constructions of self and narrative in these records. This approach challenges theatre historians, in particular, to see plea rolls not solely as repositories of data, but also as productive sites for the crafting of character and plot, and to accordingly read through, rather than to search for ways around, an enrolment's forms and fictions. In the first instance, this approach involves reassessing traditional theatre historical data points, i.e. the naming of sharers and the valuation of leases, in the light of the formal and fictive norms of specific legal procedures. But, in the cases dealt with in this article, it also requires an expansion of both what and who constitute data points, and all subjects of inquiry in the first place. Little has been said about Thomasine Ostler beyond brief, misogynistic depictions of her character and important, but inevitably dated, publications from the early 20th century. 12. This article, then, not only considers the ramifications of legal forms and fiction-making for conventional theatre historiography, but asks what legal records can, and often can't, tell us about a woman with lifelong connections to early 17th century London's commercial theatre industry. The article is divided into two sections, each reading out from a single narratio. The first section asks what traces of Thomasine we can recover from her common law bill against Walter Raleigh. The section shows that whilst the enrolment's legal fictions obscure much of what actually happened, this same fictionality nevertheless enables Thomasine and her attorney to craft between them a plausible textual self. The second section develops the insights of the first, showing how a specific legal action informs the plotting of Thomasine's narratio against Heminges, and, most significantly, why this matters for understanding the actions, motivations, and relationships of the parties in Thomasine's better-known suit. Finally, a conclusion casts new light on the aftermath of both suits, drawing upon fresh evidence from legal documents previously unknown to theatre historians. It also considers the role of the attorneys, demonstrating that representational fictions challenge straightforward notions of a litigant's presence and or persona in enrolments. The article makes these arguments in the light of important developments in theatre historical scholarship, which is increasingly showing the significant involvements of women as investors, leaseholders, artisans, and managers with London's commercial theatres. 13. The article's arguments, however, have ramifications not just for theatre historians, but more broadly for literary scholars interested in histories of women and gender. Valuable work by Francis E. Dolan, Lotta Vickers, and Subal Mukherjee has already brought the tools of literary analysis to bear on female subjecthood in the vernacular bills and depositions taken down by England's church and equity courts. 14. Social and legal historians such as Laura Gowing, Cynthia Herrop, Krista Kesselring, Alexandra Shepherd, and Tim Stretton have likewise vitally considered the traces of female voices and or gendered subjectivities in English legal records, again with an emphasis on the vernacular records of equity, conciliar, and ecclesiastical courts, 15. If the idea that we can read legal records for their literary construction, then, has long been familiar to early modernists, the perception of common law court records specifically is, to quote Vickers, less than helpful, has resulted in the plea rolls themselves being paid almost no attention by literary scholars in search of sources relating to women's lives and stories. 16. This article therefore more broadly challenges scholars to rethink the value of plea rolls as sources for both women's and theatre history, and to consequently reassess their approaches to them. This requires not only recognizing the real and significant presence of women like Thomasine Ostler in the records of England's central common law courts, but reconsidering what it is possible to learn from enrolments like that of Ostler versus Heminges. Plea rolls may well account for the silent majority of women's involvements with early modern England's central legal system, and thereby promise significant discoveries to future researchers. This article uses Thomasine's cases to model a methodology for this work. The enrolments of Thomasine's suits were discovered by Charles William Wallace and Haldor Bergren Wallace in the early 20th century. A partial translation of Ostler versus Heminges was subsequently published by Charles in the Times on the 4th of October 1909, a publication which he trailed with an article 2 days earlier summarizing and interpreting the case. 17. In the earlier article, Wallace noted in passing, and without citation, the existence of Thomasine's suit against Wat Raleigh, the bill for which was filed in the late spring of 1616, about 8 months after the instigation of Ostler versus Heminges. For Wallace, this second suit was quite another story and subsidiary to his matter at hand. 18. The suit was instead of use to Wallace primarily for what he took to be its evidencing of a romance between Thomasine and Wat, and of what he consequently portrayed to be the young widow's headstrong and hysterical disposition. 19. Edwin Nungesser, likewise, in his still much cited A Dictionary of Actors, 1929, used Thomasine's later suit to dismiss its plaintiff, having noted without evidence Thomasine's romantic episode with the rakish young Walter Raleigh. Nungesser found itself evident that a man of character, ability, and credit such as Heminges should wish to restrain his daughter, who, Nungesser decided, had apparently lost no time in taking advantage of her freedom as a young widow, in spite of her father's remonstrances. 20. In a 2019 reconsideration of Wat's career, however, Fred Tromney returned to the Wallace's research notes, now held at the Huntington Library, and recovered from them the location of two enrolments connected with Thomasine's suit against Wat. 21. From these, Tromley correctly notes the lack of evidence for a romance between the pair, and importantly shows that Wallace's characterization of Thomasine's suit as one of insult and slander misrepresents the nature of Wat's offense. Nevertheless, Tromley also fails to provide full references, noting the relevant roles but not the rotulates, which I have tracked down at the National Archives, and for which I provide full citations in print for the first time. 22. Moreover, whilst Tromney's rediscovery of the documents is significant, his use of these materials is limited, and he is open about the fact that he works from translations of the entries by Helen Bradley, rather than the Latin originals. 23. Translations are undoubtedly helpful, especially for accumulating individual data points, that is, names, dates, amounts, and so forth, but crucial aspects of an entry's fictions and forms also get lost in the movement from Latin to English. As this section will show, we lose key information about Thomasine's suit in the abstraction of the text from its procedural matrix, and thereby run the risk of misrepresenting the details we are given about Thomasine and her life in the enrolment. To understand why this is so, it is important to recognize the formalistic culture of the early modern English common law. Suits at common law were commenced by original writs, each of which set in motion a fixed series of procedures. This series of procedures known as the form of action. 24, the writs available were prescribed on a pre-existing register, with the result being that legal rights and remedies only existed to the extent to which a writ existed on this register to give them a procedural form. Courts of common law could only consider the face of the record, allegations of fact expressed through the stereotype Latin formulae distinct to each form of action. Pleadings were thereby bound to strict narrative templates and so-called books of entries, collections of sample enrolments. unsurprisingly became essential tools for the legal professionals responsible for drafting pleas on behalf of their clients. 25. The precise format of an enrollment is court-specific and huge numbers of so-called mean, that is intermediary, process entries give the rules of the Court of Common Pleas a different feeling to those of the King's Bench. The King's Bench having siphoned off its equivalent mean process entries into different file series as early as the 1550s, 26. Nevertheless, whilst there may have been a few differences in the formality of the three central common law courts, there were, as Thomas Powell's The Attorney's Academy, 1623, put it, none in the substance of their mysteries. 27. The records of all three are entirely circumscribed by the Latin formulae of the jurisdiction's strict hierarchical writ system. Enrollments, then, are not transcripts of court proceedings, but, rather, the records of formal stages in litigation, and only those, moreover, that litigants paid to have enrolled. They contain no details of trials, recording only the verdict and judgment in a posterior, or afterwards, below the original enrollment, and even these are uncommon because the vast majority of civil suits were settled or abandoned long before a jury trial. In this sense, the enrollment of Ostler versus Raleigh is atypical. It contains not just the pleadings, but a posterior including the result of a trial. Its structure is, nonetheless, entirely characteristic of a format repeated over three centuries worth of record keeping. The entry begins with a copy of Thomasine's original bill, telling us at the outset that her complaint is a form of trespass action. Et pretulat hic incuria dicti domini regis tunquit bidem quantum billum suam, de placito transgressionis, and then and there brought here in the court of the said Lord King, a certain bill of hers. In a plea of trespass. 28 it then details Thomasine's narratio, or opening complaint, and Wout's placitum, or plea in response, each of which was filed with the court by their respective attorneys, Thomas Farrer and John Hughes. The object of pleading was to settle the legal issue in dispute and, upon entry of Wout's placitum, issue between the two parties was joined. The posterior then records that Watt was later found guilty by a jury at the Guildhall in London, on the 3rd of December, 1616. These intertwined contexts, jurisdictional, bureaucratic, procedural, and linguistic, are key to understanding the enrollment of Ostler versus Raleigh, and, in turn, what I argue to be the necessity of fiction to its form composition. Thomasine's narratio, for example, is entirely dependent upon a blend of legal fictions and creative practice. I quote most of it here, omitting 23 words from the start that introduced the names of plaintiff and defendant. Ipse decimo di me jano reni domine jacobinum regis angli decimo quarto viet armis etc. in ipsum thomasinum apud londonium vitilis et in pirocia beatum rebus arcibus, in warder de cheap londoni insultum fecit et ipsum thomasinum tant get. Ipidem vulneroid et malattractoid et ipsum thomasinum tantis in iuriis et allegis malattracti omnibus abusus fut quod edem Thomasina circa negatia sua agenda et per agenda palim et publis incidium non audibat et alienormia ea intulit contrapassum. Dicti domini regis nunc ad damnum aetius Thomasine coengenterum liberum 29. E. That is what, on the 10th day of May in the 14th year of the reign of the Lord James, now King of England, that is the 10th of May, 1616, assaulted Thomasine with force in arms, etc., at London, to wit, in the parish of St. Mary Lebo in Cheap Ward, and then and there he, that is what, injured and ill-treated Thomasine, and Thomasine was abused with so many injuries and other ill-treatments, that the same Thomasine did not dare to go about her affairs openly and publicly by herself, and he inflicted other great wrongs to her against the king's peace to the loss of the selfsame Thomasine of £500. In the earliest common law courts, trespass writs covered a range of possible actions, such as the taking of goods and land ejectment, with each variant form of action related by virtue of their shared basic formulae and common procedure. 13th century efforts to discourage litigants from bringing their private disputes into the monarch's courts, however, led to restrictions being placed on trespass actions. Trespass writs would subsequently only be issued to complainants of forcible wrongs that had been committed viet armis, with force in arms, and contrapassum regis against the king's peace. Full stop. But, far from discouraging litigants, the narratological restrictions that were placed on trespass complaints, seem primarily to have encouraged the creativity of plaintiffs. Baker, for example, notes allegations against carpenters for chopping up timber via Thomas, as well as the remarkable case of Rattlesdene versus Grunerstone and Grunerstone, 1317, in which the defendants Mary and Richard were accused of selling contaminated wine via Armis Scelic et Gladi Isar Cubus et Sagitis, Agradantnum etc. Contrapassum etc., with force and arms, namely, with swords, bows, and arrows, to the grave damage, etc., and against the peace, etc. 31. These early examples are more extreme than the later ones in their contortion of circumstances to fit the required tropes and forms of a trespass action. Nevertheless, in the early 17th century, the linguistic constructions of the trespass writ were still being used to frame a wide variety of situations, all loosely connected by their varying, often elastic senses of what constituted a forcible act. These situations included the refusal on the 1st of September 1609 of six carpenters to pay for their second round of drinks at the Queen's Head in St. Giles without Cripplegate, London, and the improvident steering, improvindo gubernatio, off a wagon by a Norfolk husbandman in September 1613.32, whilst phrases like force and arms and other great wrongs may sound ominous in English, then they need instead to be seen as narratological necessities, as kinds of action, specific fiction. For instance, et alia enormia ei injulit was a form of aggravation clause specific to trespass actions that are to be included if the plaintiff wished to increase the amount claimed in damages. Similarly, as David Ibbotson writes, to say that something had been done against the king's peace meant very little more than that it was within the king's jurisdiction. The clause had none of the overtones of public disorder that were associated with breach of a peace. 33. Even the lists of weaponry that often populate trespass complaints are not descriptive. No wine was forcefully contaminated with bows and arrows. Rather, these clauses were of value precisely because they were fictitious, and they were consequently considered by the courts to be non-traversable, that is, non-contestable, in pleading, which meant that their veracity could never be challenged by defendants. We consequently need to be careful when drawing upon such phrases as historical evidence for what actually happened between Thomasine and Watt. All which, however, isn't necessarily to say that it would be wrong to paint Watt's actions on the 10th of May as violent assault. We just need to pay attention to different linguistic markers than the non-traversable fictions highlighted in the previous paragraphs. Trespass, as noted, was the name for a group or family of writs, and could be subdivided into a number of different forms. These included, to quote the law French headings in Edward Coke's 1614 Book of Entries, close debruser, breaking close, prendre des boeufs, taking an ox, herbs de fowler, trampling grass, and assault and battery. 34. The constructions that distinguish the last of these from other forms of trespass action appear in the passage above. The assault, in ipsum thermasinum, insultum fecit, and the battery, ad tunc et habidem vulnerabit et malattractorit. 35. Because these clauses were considered to be traversable, that is, contestable in pleading, a plaintiff's allegations of beating and ill treatment needed to bear a closer relation to reality than did those of force and arms. A defendant could, after all, challenge the relevancy of a traversable clause to the circumstances in question. Yet, even on this point, scholars need to remain cautious, as the enrolment of a suit contemporaneous with Ostler versus Raleigh demonstrates. Enrolled in Easter 1616, the narratio describes how the defendant, George Ward, had assaulted, insultum fecit, the plaintiff, Thomas Weaver, and further beaten, injured, and mistreated him, verberor vulnerabit et malattractorit. All standard assault and battery forms. 36. Ward's plea in response, however, reveals that the defendant had, in fact, accidentally shot the plaintiff with a musket as part of a training exercise. The point is not an absence of violence from such suits, but rather to note with Baker that whilst a wide range of accidents qualified as battery, the circumstances were obscured from view by the sameness of the writs and counts. 37. It was only in instances of so-called special pleading, like Ward's, that such circumstances might emerge onto the court record, and these more technical forms of pleading had become decidedly uncommon by the beginning of the 17th century. 38. The majority of defendants instead pleaded the general issue, a kind of broad denial in which the truth of every material allegation was put in dispute. What? Pleaded not guilty, ipse non estate interculpabilis, and in doing so ensured that the particulars of his assault of Thomasine remained off the record, to be instead put in evidence to a jury. 39. This means that we likewise get no specifics about Wyatt's actions. So, what is it possible to say about Thomasine in her suit beyond simply noting her narratio's use of fiction? S. One way to answer this question is to locate the narratio's departures from the formal norms of assault and battery procedures. I have already discussed the narratio's formulaic aspects, and specifically the long history behind clauses such as viet armis and insultum fecit. However, comparison with two other contemporaneous assault and battery complaints reveals what follows these standard clauses to be more distinctive. The first example is taken from Coke's Book of Entries, printed in 1614, viet armis, etc. Videlis et, gladiges, bacillis, et cartellis in ipsum fomum apud Newport panel insultum feserunt et ipsum verberorant, vulnerorant, et malattractorant, ita quanta eius vita desperabiter, et alia enormia etc., ad gradamnum etc., et contrapassum etc. 40, with force and arms, etc. to wit, with swords, sticks, and daggers, they assaulted Thomas at Newport Pagnell and beat him, injured him, and mistreated him so that his life was despaired for, and other great wrongs etc., to the grave damage etc., and against the peace etc. The second example comes from the enrolment of the narratio of Elizabeth Sisma and her husband John in the plea rolls of the King's Bench, for Hilary term 1616, insultum fecit et, ipsum Elizabethum ad tung et ibid en verberant vulnerant et malattractant ita quod vita us maximo disperibat 41. As these examples suggest, the convention in counts of assault and battery was to assert that the defendant's violent actions had left the plaintiff's life to be despaired for. Ita quod eius vita desperabiter. By contrast, Thomasine's narratio describes the consequences of Wyatt's assault in the following way. Insultum fecit et ipsum thomasinum ad tung et ibidem vulneroit et malattractuit et ipsum thomasinum tantus in iurias et allergis malattracti omnibus abusus fut quod edem Thomasina circa negatia sua agenda et per agenda palum et publis insidionon. Order but 42. Instead of the conventional accusation, Thomasine's injuries and ill treatments are alleged to be so numerous that Thomasine did not dare to go about her affairs openly and publicly by herself. Thomasina circa negatia sua agenda et per agenda palum et publis insidia non audibat. The takeaway here is not just that this particular clause is distinctive, but that we can only register this by knowing the procedural template from which it departs. It is, in other words, only by engaging with the norms that shape the composition of Thomasine's narratio that we can uncover distinguishing features of her suit. The clause most clearly draws upon the construction often used in common law complaints of intimidation or menace, as in 5 of the 9 sample enrolments given for minors, that is menace. In the 1596 edition of William Rastall's A Collection of Entrees, 43, all 5 examples employ some variation on circa negatia sua, palum insidia non audibat, that is, they all claim that the defendant's intimidating actions hindered the plaintiff's capacity to go about their affairs openly. 44. The use of the accusative plural negatia, from negatium, situates these constructions within the language of business, and require that Thomasine's own affairs, negatia sua, likewise be understood in the sense of employment or occupation. 45. In the conclusion to this essay, I will draw upon new evidence to discuss the possibility that Thomasine made a living as a money lender. For now, however, it is possible to infer that, whatever Thomasine's livelihood may have been, the sums involved in it were not insignificant. This is because her narratio explicitly casts the consequence of Wyatt's actions to be economic loss, whilst Thomasine's claim for damages of £500 may well incorporate a degree of punitive logic. The sum is presented as being about the income she has lost as a result of being unable to openly go about her business. This £500 figure cannot, of course, be taken as an accurate valuation of Thomasine's affairs, not least because the court eventually awarded her the still significant but lesser sum of £260.46. Nevertheless, both the sum claimed in the sum awarded point towards Thomasine being of no little affluence and financial independence at the time of the assault in May 1616. The fictionality of Thomasine's complaint also presents another way for theatre historians to, as Cordelia Beatty puts it, make a link between the legal text and the lived life. 47. Victoria Kahn reminds us that the idea of making poiesis was fundamental to early modern conceptions of fiction, and this significant insight underwrites my own sense that the historically contingent fictionality of common law narratio should be understood to have productive dimensions. 48. Past scholarship on women's voices in legal records has been generally informed by the notion of a separation between a fictive legal persona and a lived authentic self. Viewed through this notion, the real Thomasine Ostler lies concealed beneath the fictions and forms of the enrolment, leaving us instead with the subject positions occupied in relation to the subjectivities of the law. Yet, such a depiction would, I think, also be to miss the extent to which the real and the fictional are coextensive in common law contexts, an understanding that can enable us to make links between the enrolment's fictions and Thomasine herself. Writing of late medieval chancery petitions, Beatty importantly reminds us that if a petitioner wanted her complaint to be redressed, she needed to ensure that she could occupy the subject position, s, adopted in the bill, that is, whilst written documents were the primary means through which a litigant communicated their version of events to the court, these documents were also constructed with the prospect of defending allegations in person later on in the legal process. 49. This recognition leads Beatty to propose that we think of complainants in chancery bills as petitioning subjects, as textual subjects produced by the process of petitioning the court itself in a common law setting. This model allows us to think of Thomasine not only in terms of a real fictional dichotomy, but as what I call a narrated self. The narrated self, I argue, is the textual self produced through the process of pleading in the common law courts, a productive fiction crafted through, indeed, entirely enabled by, the common law's strict narratological norms. What kind of self, then, is being narrated by Thomasine's attorney, Thomas Farrer, in this creative reconstitution of legal procedures? Most significantly, I suggest, the narratio asserts a kind of occupational identity for Thomasine in the face of what Laura Gowing describes as the numerous obstacles to women's economic autonomy in early modern England. 50. Whereas male plaintiffs tend to be introduced in enrolments by way of their rank or occupational title, women are instead routinely framed through the prism of their marital status. For example, Venet Thomasine Ostler Vidal, came Thomasine Ostler, a widow. 51. Alexandra Shepherd has shown, however, that scholars would do better to look beyond nouns to the verb forms used in legal records to describe the daily lives of women. Writing of female witnesses in church courts, Shepherd notes that women only rarely assumed occupational titles, for example, innkeeper, instead referring to their work in terms of the tasks they performed. For example, sells ale stroke keeps an inn. 52. A similar logic applies to the narratio's presentation of Thomasine. She is categorized as a widow even as she is described as having commercial activities that need to be performed, negotia sua agenda et per agenda. This presentation matters for our reading of both Thomasine and her suit, especially for the ways in which it runs contrary to the story told a century ago by Wallace and Nungesser. Thomasine and her attorney clearly felt it plausible to narrate Thomasine primarily as an economic agent, and the jury at the Guildhall notably seems to have taken no exception to this subject positioning either. The choice to articulate Watt's assault through the frame of economic loss can, I argue, thus be seen as part of a claim to an occupational identity. Thomasine is presented and assessed as a working person in the enrolment, so we, too, might consider her on the same terms. Indeed, what evidence exists implies that some form of commercial relationship between Thomasine and Watt is more likely than a romantic one. Fiction matters, most simply, to both the narratio's formal composition and the narration of selfhood and enrolments. As formulaic as the plea roles may be, they are also dependent upon a blend of legal fictions and creative practice. Even in a narratio as brief as Thomasine's against Watt, we can discern the contours of a practice of making whereby character and plot are constituted through the templates of specific legal forms and procedures. This insight can, in turn, help us to better understand Thomasine's much lengthier complaint against her father, the actor John Heminges, and it is to the enrolment of Thomasine's earlier suit that the second section of this essay now turns. To Thomasine's suit against Heminges is more familiar to theatre historians, but for many years scholars were forced to rely on partial translations of its enrolment. These were published by Charles Wallace in 1909, Carl Grabau in 1910, and E.K. Chambers in 1930, all three of them prioritizing sections relating to Shakespeare, that is the Globe and Blackfriars indentures. 0.53 more recently, however, digital facsimiles of Ostler versus Heminges have been made available to consult on Shakespeare documented, and Nina Green's full transcription has been online since 2011.54. Nevertheless, despite this greater availability of the document, important aspects of Thomasine's suit are yet to be accounted for. In this second section, I therefore ask what we can learn about the suit, its protagonists, and the playhouse shares at its center by paying attention to the procedural, rhetorical, and linguistic contexts of the suit's enrolment. I begin by summarizing some of the background to the case. On the 20th of May, 1611, when he was probably 24 or 25 years old, William Ostler signed indentures for a 1/7 interest in the Blackfriars Playhouse. 55 on the 20th of February, 1612, he also signed indentures for a 1/7 part of a half interest in the ground lease of the Globe. 56 a.m. former leading member of the Children of the Queen's Revels. Ostler had joined the King's Men at some point between April 1609 and their staging of The Alchemists in 1610.57. He and Thomasine Heminges, the daughter of his new colleague John, married at some point in 1610 or 1611, and their son, Beaumont, was baptized at St. Mary Aldermanbury on the 18th of May, 1612.58. Only 2.5 years after Beaumont's baptism, however, his father died suddenly on the 16th of December, 1614. William had died without leaving a will, and so administration of his estate was granted to his 19-year-old widow, Thomasine. Thomasine later claimed that her husband's shares had been the whole estate, totum statum, left to her not just for her maintenance, but also for the settling of her late husband's debt. 59 The problem was that the shares themselves were in the hands of her father, William's senior colleague, John Heminges. According to Thomasine's narratio against Heminges, likely filed in the King's Bench on the 9th of October, 1615, Heminges claimed that the two shares had been granted to him in trust, with the English word notably intruding into the Latin of the enrolment, concessionis et assignationis, sibi profato iohanni Heminges per predictum will elmum ostula de fiducia Anglesia of trust, a grant and assignment, made to the said John Heminges by the aforesaid William Ostler of trust. In English of trust. 60, in instances where specific phrasing or thing were integral to the assessment of a case, attorneys and clerks generally employed either avocatus, called, or anglicy. In English, clause, capital A, vocatus was used in circumstances where no exact equivalent existed in classical Latin. For example, whilst the concept of theatre, theatrum, would have been familiar to an ancient Roman, less so would have been the commercial nexus of houses, for example, tiring house, tap house, music house, house of office, that together comprised the early modern English playhouse. Hence the need for Thomas Farrar to clarify via the vocate clause that domus lucere thereafter be understood as a playhouse. 61, by contrast, an anglicy clause provided clarification where the exact wording, or thing, was considered to be a fact of judicial importance, for example murum tegularium anglicy brick wall, as in the narratio of Giles Allen and Sarah Allen against Cuthbert Burbage, enrolled in the King's Bench as part of a suit involving the theatre in Shoreditch in Easter 1602.62. The vernacular trust, in other words, is not accidental, nor a sign of deficient Latin on the part of Thomasine's attorney, but instead a clarification that Heminges had laid claim to the shares through a specific legal mechanism. Because the validity of the trust was never at stake during the pleadings, no further details of its alleged creation and composition are forthcoming. The problem nonetheless for Thomasine was that even its theoretical existence threatened her legal interest in the shares. In creating a trust, a settlor, that is William Ostler, relinquished legal ownership of an asset, that is the shares, to a trustee, that is John Heminges. The trustee, in turn, managed the asset to the benefit of a third party, who was called the beneficiary. Thomasine's narratio described the trust as feigned, pretense, and so we are unsurprisingly given no indication as to the prospective beneficiary in this particular case. One possibility, however, if William did indeed set up some form of trust with Heminges during his lifetime, is that the arrangement was originally intended to the benefit of Thomasine and Beaumont. Thomasine was under 21 years old at the time, and so it would not have been unusual for her father to be granted control of the shares as a kind of custodianship. Whether the trust was real or feigned, however, what we can say is that there is little proof of Heminges acting here. As Wallace and his successors have argued, in any kind of corporate capacity, 63 indeed, given other evidence, such as Heminges' personal loan in 1606 to Anne Witter and John Witter, through which he gained possession of the mortgage of the Witter's part interest in the gallery's ground and playhouse of the Globe and Gardens. It seems just as if not more likely that Heminges was acting to aggregate shares in his own interests than behaving as the business manager and agent of the King's Men. 64 In the early 17th century, trust litigation was the preserve of the Equity Court of Chancery. As Maria L. Shiany writes, the trust was its, that is Chancery's, creature, and over it the court exercised an original, peculiar, an exclusive jurisdiction. 65 Chancery, as Shiany shows in her pioneering essay, was also sympathetic towards young, single women coming before the court to seek their inheritance. 66 It makes sense, then, to discover that, after 9 months of failed appeals to her father for delivery, deliberandum, of the shares, it was to Chancery that Thomasine originally turned, filing suit in the Equity Court for their recovery pro recuperationer, on the 20th of September, 1615. 67 The court granted Thomasine a writ of subpoena, which would have summoned Heminges to appear before the writ's return date of the 14th of October on conditions of a penalty. 68 As early as the 26th of September, however, having received word of a Chancery writ, Heminges set about persuading Thomasine to stay her equity suit, succeeding by promising to recompense her to the true value, verum valorum, of the contested shares. 69 Thomasine estimated the true value of the remaining years in these two-part shares in the playhouse, leases to be £300 each. But theatre historians should be a little cautious before using this figure to determine the contemporary value of a playhouse share, as, with the trust, the value of the shares was never at issue during the pleadings, and the precise connection between the contents of the indentures and their valuation at £300 is never quite made explicit in the enrolment. Moreover, in the absence of a posterior, and afterwards, recording a verdict and judgment, we have no way of knowing whether the court considered Thomasine's £300 figure to be in any way proximate. Whatever the accuracy of Thomasine's valuation, however, no money appears to have been forthcoming as of the 5th of October, when Thomasine's request to her father for performance of his promise seems to have gone ignored. Thomasine's subsequent instigation of a common lawsuit is therefore not hugely surprising, and a bill for breach of promise was filed against Heminges at the earliest opportunity, the 9th of October being the first day of Michaelmas term. The common law action for a breach of promise was a subsit, from the Latin, she stroke he had undertaken, itself a subspecies of the family of actions known as trespass on the case, making a subset a subspecies of trespass on the case in the way that battery was a subspecies of trespass. Accusations of plotting were integral to trespass on the case, just as force in arms was fundamental in trespass. 70 These accusations were usually expressed through the word machinans, the present participle of the verb machina, in the Latin comedies read in the grammar schools of early modern England. Machina carried the sense of to contrive artfully, to scheme, or plot, and it is freighted with this same sense of artful contrivance in trespass on the case narrations. 71. The construction enabled litigants to draw upon tropes of deceit in order to position a defendant's behavior as a wrong requiring financial compensation. Wrong, here, as distinct from a right, the ongoing infringement of which would have required vindication, as opposed to monetary damages. The presentation of Heminges' failure to pay in the following terms is therefore wholly conventional. Machinans et fraudulent intendens indem thamasinum in hac parte calide et sed ul desapere et defrauda, plotting and fraudulently intending to deviously and craftily deceive and defraud the same Thomasine. 72. Whilst this accusation against Heminges may well have been true, in other words, it was also an accusation always already plotted. If plotting is standard across an entire family of actions, then there are also specific assumpted tropes. We have already encountered one in actions like Thomasine's of so-called collateral assumpted. It was necessary to detail not only the performance of the promise had been often requested, cepius requisitus, but also to name the specific time and place of the requesting. 73. Another emerges in Thomasine's claim that her staying of suit in Chancery was a direct result of her trusting to the promise and undertaking of her father. The clause promissione et assumptione predicta Ihannis fidem ad habens drawn from a long history of assumpsit narrations. 74. Most crucially of all, any assumpsit action required consideration to be held actionable in a common law court, evidenced most clearly by the use of consideration as a marginal heading in all of the sample assumpsit enrolments in Coke's Book of Entries. 75. In the words of the jurist John Cowell, consideration was the material cause, without the which no contract bindeth. 76. Without it, promises were held to be bare or naked, nudum pactum, and thus unenforceable at law. In practical terms, this required plaintiffs to demonstrate some form of quid pro quo in order to make the moment of undertaking actionable. Attorneys achieved this in ratio by pairing two contingent sub-clauses, one, in consideration a quod, in consideration that, and two, superse sumpsit et fidli to promise it, took upon themselves and faithfully promised. The liability of the latter clause was entirely predicated upon the former. For example, in consideration that the plaintiff did something, the defendant took upon themselves and faithfully promised. With this in mind, I quote at length the description in Thomasine's narratio of the events of the 26th of September, 1615. In consideration a quod predicta Thomasina ad instantium et specialum requisitionum predicti Ihannis Heminges, 1. De fear velit sectum Anglisi wild stay her suit, 2. Abstinia velit ad desavindum undum Iohannum cum predicto brevid a subpoena, Anglisi wald forbe the servinge of the subpoena upon the sedion et, 3. Vaterius si edum Thomasina accedia velut ad ipsum Iohannum existentum patrum Iapsius Thomasine ad faciendum obedientium suam Anglisi to do her duty profato Iohanni et cedum rubex Heminges existenti matriacidum Thomasine, superse, assumpsit idemc, Thomasina tunc et abidem fidli to promise it quod, ipse idem Iohanns verum valorum pro omnibus et singulis promissus predictus. Thomasine bene et fidli to satisficere et contenta velit. 77. Or, in briefer words, in consideration that Thomasine would, 1. Stay her bill in Chancery, 2. Refrain from serving the writ of subpoena, and, 3. Do her duty to her parents, Rebecca and John, Heminges took upon himself, and then and there faithfully promised that he would satisfy and content Thomasine to the true value of the shares. I earlier discussed the Anglisi clause, and here its interpretive affordances are particularly visible. Each burst of the vernacular directs our attention towards the three-part consideration that underwrites Thomasine's assumpsit action. 1. Stay her suit. 2. Forbear the servinge of the subpoena. And 3. Do her duty. So told, the promise of recompense is given in exchange for three conditions explicitly requested by Heminges. Although a consideration ad instantium et specialum requisitionum, at the urging and special request of the defendant, is another common assumpsit trope. 78. It is possible to see such moments as ironically highlighting the impossibility of hearing the real Thomasine, or, at the very least, her speech, within these formulaic records. Whilst these moments are presented as documents of Heminges speaking, there is no trace of the words Thomasine may have spoken to her father in response. I want to nonetheless conclude this section by arguing that there remain important things that we can learn about Thomasine, and about Heminges, by examining not just the constitution of their characters, but the ways in which this characterization is gendered in Thomasine's narratio. Heminges, we are told, not only required of Thomasine a display of filial piety, but for it to be performed at her parents' house in St. Mary Aldermanbury. Thomasine, in turn, claims to have obliged on the 26th of September, narrating how with tears dripping from her eyes, vidis abaculis susis delantibus, she had, as requested, humbled herself at her parents' feet. 79 in the Times, Charles Wallace had leapt to Heminges' defense at this point, claiming that the lifelong friend and fellow of Shakespeare was pictured quite wrongly in Thomasine's complaint. 80 lacking evidence to support this conjecture, however, Wallace instead cast doubt on Thomasine's testimony by turning its pathos against her. For Wallace, the pitiful picture was proof of Thomasine's hysterical character, and he presents the fact that Thomasine goes one day to her parents but never again as confirmation of an inconstant nature. 81 Wallace, of course, was writing more than a century ago, and we in the present might take a different perspective, especially as theatre historians become increasingly aware of some of Heminges' less savoury behaviours. 82 The power dynamics between Thomasine and her father were gendered and unequal. Even if widowhood conferred onto Thomasine a degree of legal agency, Heminges' request that Thomasine humble herself as a condition for payment seems, to me at least, to consciously re-inscribe and reinforce these dynamics. The plotting of this moment also has the effect of positioning Thomasine in terms of weakness, dependence, and subordination. This may be different to the active kind of occupational identity I have argued to be narrated in the later suit against Watt, but the gendered aspects to Thomasine's characterizations nevertheless link the two enrolments. As already discussed, the use of verb forms to articulate forms of occupational selfhood appears to have been more of a female than male practice. Likewise, the emotive subject positioning in the narratio against Heminges is redolent of strategies identified by historians as being employed in other courts. By and on behalf of women litigants, Tim Stretton, for example, has shown how tropes of poverty, weakness, and dependency recur in women's pleadings in the Court of Requests. Further commenting on the similarity between the values these pleadings contain and those propagated in sermons and conduct literature. 83 Trust, too, is the key issue in the equity cases Stretton examines, notably in suits between parents and children, in which, as Stretton writes, the act of going to court itself was considered a breach of trust, and thereby an inversion of the natural order. 84 Thomasine's common law bill against Heminges, in other words, is a jurisdiction-specific iteration of broader patriarchal discourses, whereby the trusting intrinsic to an assumpted action intersects with the trust as not just a legal instrument, but a relation between father and daughter. Similarly, descriptions of, for example, Thomasine's reverence and humility, reverentia et humilitat, in response to her father's actions work to constitute a self in line with broader gendered behavioral expectations. 85. This framing crafts a set of subordinate subject positions for Thomasine, with a prospective trial jury in mind, and Thomasine's rehiring of Thomas Farrow for the later suit against Watt suggests that she wasn't entirely dissatisfied with this positioning, or, at least, with the suit's final outcome. Fiction may be key to understanding the composition of common law narrations, but so, too, are the gender and gendered norms underwriting them. Conclusion, in propria persona. So, what happened after the filing of Thomasine's narratio in Michaelmas 1615? At first, not much. Heminges asked for and was granted an impalance, that is an adjournment, pushing things back into Hilary term. Hilary 1616 began on the 23rd of January, and the enrolment tells us that Heminges, as per the conditions of the impalance, entered his placitum on this date. A previously unknown entry in the rule books of the King's Bench, however, reveals this note to be formulaic. Defendants routinely fail to appear after an impalance, and, in such instances, the court could issue a so-called peremptory day. This required defendants to deliver their answer by a later peremptory date, otherwise judgment would be entered against them. 86 With no plea evidently forthcoming on the 23rd of January, the King's Bench issued just such a date to Heminges on the 27th of January, setting the Wednesday next after the 18th day of Hilary, that is the 7th of February, as the die peremptorio. 87 The reason for the delay is not mentioned. It could betray a lack of confidence on Heminges' part, or could have been an effort to infuriate his daughter. But, read alongside his earlier efforts to stay the Chancery suit, it does, at least, appear to point towards a broader reticence to dispute the shares in court. Did Ostler versus Heminges ever come to a trial, then? I think it most likely that it did not. The suit's plea roll entry may conclude by noting that the jury was to be summoned at Westminster on the 8th of February. But this, too, is formulaic. Civil trials usually took place at a sessions elsewhere before a single judge, rather than before the full complement of justices at Westminster, a system known as nisi pris. In a London context, this meant that civil trials were usually heard at the Guildhall, as was the case for Thomasine's suit against Watt, where the posterior would be taken down by a trial court clerk, and then referred back to the King's Bench for later enrolment. 88. A lack of posterior therefore makes it highly unlikely that Ostler versus Heminges ever came before a jury, and this supposition is strengthened by the suit's categorization in the court's docket rolls, which were the repertory rolls of the chief clerk's business. Each entry in the docket is marked by a shorthand note, recording a suit's current stage of proceedings. So, for instance, Ostler versus Raleigh is introduced by a far to document the procurement of the venire facias writ necessary for empanelling a jury, without which there could be no trial. 89. By contrast, there is no record that a venire facias writ was ever obtained in the suit against Heminges. The docket roll appears to record only a continuation of the suit from the previous term, consumile, and thereafter no more. 90. Does this make settlement the most likely outcome? I would argue so, although a non-suit is also possible, which would have involved either the renunciation of the suit, surely inconsistent with Thomasine's prior behavior, or a determination by the court that the evidence presented was insufficient to establish a prima facie case. 91. What we can say with confidence, however, is that, irrespective of the legal outcome, Heminges retained control of the shares. Theatre historians have long assumed as much from the account of Heminges' Globe and Blackfriars holdings in the sharers' papers dispute of 1635, but what has previously only been inference can now be confirmed by the judicial contours of an assumpted action, which, as discussed in Section 2, framed actions as completed wrongs requiring financial compensation. 92. Historical interest in the playhouse shares has perhaps distracted from the fact that what Thomasine demands is financial damages, rather than the return of the shares themselves, unlike in the aborted chancery suit. In other words, Heminges' continued possession of the shares was never in question. So, did Thomasine receive any kind of restitution from Heminges? New evidence from the Court of Requests raises the possibility that some kind of financial settlement was reached, particularly when considered in conjunction with the earlier articulation of an occupational identity for Thomasine, as discussed in Section 1. In a bill of complaint dated the 4th of November, 1618, Thomasine is named as one of five co-defendants by painter Stainer Ralph Treswell Jr., who was seeking forbearance from his many creditors. 93. Treswell acknowledges a debt to Thomasine of £51, making Thomasine the painter Stainer's most significant creditor. But, in her answer, delivered in writing on the 19th of November, Thomasine accuses Treswell of having spent a good deal more than £51 of her money. The rhetoricity of legal argumentation means that we should be careful in the absence of other evidence to take the figures given in Thomasine's answer too literally. Nonetheless, the document claims between far all £200 to have been loaned to Treswell via Dewis, and sewer all sums of money, and the hefty amounts involved do point towards a young woman of no little affluence, at least when her interactions with Treswell began. 94. 2 years earlier, Thomasine had claimed the playhouse shares to be the whole estate left to her for her maintenance, and her subsequent outlays, potentially in the hundreds of pounds, perhaps therefore evidence receipt of compensation from her father. 95. They certainly suggest that, like many women in early modern England, she was active in forms of credit broking and or money lending. Thomasine's funding of Treswell may also have been enabled by part payment of the £260 damages she had been awarded in the suit against Watt. Although events following the trial on the 3rd of December, 1616, make it seem unlikely that any money was forthcoming from Watt himself. 96. On the 1st of February, 1617, Watt was granted a writ of error by the Exchequer Chamber, an appellate court, and by the time the original verdict was confirmed on the 31st of May, Watt was not much longer for London. In June, he sailed with his father as part of the latter's colonial venture to Guyana, and it was there that he was shot during an assault on Spanish-controlled San Tome in January 1618.97. It was thus not Watt, but his two sureties, the blacksmith, William Stone, and the draper, Thomas Jennings, whom Thomasine pursued for unpaid damages in Michaelmas 1619, with £114.1460 allegedly still outstanding. 98 per the enrolment of the related recovery, or sire facias, proceedings, Stone and Jennings were ordered by the King's Bench to appear at Westminster on 8 and the 16th of November, but neither on either occasion did. 99 as in all recovery enrolments, there are thus no pleadings to examine, but the entry still offers one final insight into why fiction matters to our reading of enrolments. Because, whilst neither Stone nor Jennings may have attended court, Thomasine almost certainly did. On both 8 and the 16th of November, she is recorded as appearing in propria persona sua, in her own person to hear the return of her writ in court. 101 cents, this is unremarkable, as comparison with other sire facias entries makes clear. Defendants almost always represented themselves at this stage of proceedings. Playwright John Webster, for instance, twice appeared in propria persona sua to learn of the default of Thomas Decker to his sire facias writ. 101 But such moments also ironically evidence the otherwise largely concealed work of a particular kind of representational fiction in these records. Between 1615 and 1619, the King's Bench records several appearances by Thomasine at Westminster, with just our two November exceptions, however, all of these are mediated through her attorney, Thomas Farrer. 102 As representatives, attorneys acted as the agents of their clients, managing the formal aspects of a suit, and standing as substitutes when a litigant was absent from court. Few of Thomasine's recorded appearances would have actually required her to attend court in person, so, whilst it seems safe to assume that she attended the Guild Hall for the trial against Watt, in which she would likely have been required to testify, we thus need to be more cautious in any analysis of her appearances at Westminster in the King's Bench. The point is not that Thomasine was necessarily absent from court on all or even any of the dates in question, but rather to remind scholars that, unless stated, we cannot presume that she was physically present. This article has instead argued for an understanding of Thomasine Ostler as, first and foremost, a textual self. So configured, her complex representations, across 4 years and three enrolments, ask that we think differently about what we can, and often can't, learn about theatre history from common law court records. Copyright the author.